The China Global South podcast is supported in part by the Africa-China Reporting Project at Wits University in Johannesburg and by our subscribers. Thank you. If you'd like to subscribe for daily news and exclusive analysis about every aspect of China's engagement in Africa, Asia, and throughout the developing world, go to chinaglobalsouth.com/subscribe.
Hello and welcome to another edition of the China Global South podcast, a proud member of the Seneca Podcast Network. I'm Eric Olander in Ho Chi Minh City, Vietnam, and as always, I'm joined by China Global South's managing editor, Cobus van Staden, in Johannesburg, South Africa. A very good afternoon to you, Cobus.
Good afternoon.
Cobus, today we're going to step back a little bit from our regular day-to-day news coverage, and we're going to focus on climate issues. And this is a topic that's become increasingly prominent in our daily coverage on the site, and a little bit to some extent in the podcast. We had that long discussion, you and I, after our Nigeria debt conversation, really highlighting how climate is increasingly coming into the center of absolutely every topic that's out there today, whether it is debt or whether it's the economy or instability or whether it's even coups now. The climate issue is always in the background there. So we thought it would be really helpful to today focus specifically on climate diplomacy and the systems that are in place that are supposed to, and the operative word there, of course, is supposed to, try and remedy this situation and that are clearly failing. Last month, the G20's environment and climate ministers all got together and they met in Chennai, India. Now, India is the rotating chair of the G20, so a lot of these meetings are taking place in India. And the goal was to negotiate some kind of consensus around how quickly the world is going to transition from fossil fuels to renewable energy. This is one of those topics like hugging puppies that you would think that nobody would object to, right? They were also supposed to discuss some new carbon taxes and put some goals out there. Now, of the 68 items on the agenda, 4 did not pass, and they were big ones. The big one and the most important one was to pledge to triple renewable energy capacity by 2030. Now, again, this feels like one of those things of like at a meeting like this, sure, why not? Everybody signs on. You know, these guys almost never keep their promises. So you would think that they would just sign their name on the dotted line. And then 6-7 years from now, nobody remember that we didn't meet those targets. But they couldn't even do that. Now, the media reports that came out immediately after the meeting said Saudi Arabia, Russia, South Africa, Indonesia, and China all objected to the plan. What do they all have in common? They're all very much carbon-based economies and major exporters of fossil fuels and major consumers in the case of China's fossil fuels. Now, it's not entirely clear what happened here because the Chinese Foreign Ministry came out with a really, really angry statement after the Chennai meeting and said that reports that blame Beijing for, you know, being among the dissenters here were, and let me quote here, completely inconsistent with the facts. So, Cobus, I don't actually know what's going on, what side of the fence China was on. What I do know, and what we've seen now over the past several years, is that the systems that are in place in their current form, that are supposed to be the venues that negotiate the transition from carbon-based energy to renewable-based energy, and to pull us back from the brink of the world's temperature going up more than 1.5 degrees centigrade, are not working. And the G20 in particular is proving to be yet another disappointment. And what they're doing is they're letting down the people of the Global South, and they're letting all of us down, because let's take into account that the G20 in particular accounts for 85% of the world's GDP and 80% of global emissions. So if there's going to be a place that this is done, it would be at the G20, but you can see there just isn't any consensus here. So with that in mind, we have the COP28 mega conference that's coming up in late November and early December. That's when the big and powerful in the climate industry all get on airplanes and stay in fancy hotels and talk about all these great things and do absolutely nothing. I mean, we saw this in Egypt last year. Do you remember anything that came out of COP27 that's actually been durable? Maybe there are some things.
Loss and damage.
We can talk about that today. That's a bust, okay? And the fact that they're doing this in Dubai,
yes,
means that these guys have a sense of humor that is just kind of second to none. I mean, that's the same Dubai that's part of the United Arab Emirates that sits atop $1 trillion of natural gas. And I can keep going, but just one other point here before I know this is a passion project for you and a very, very important issue for you. But consider the fact that in January through June of this year, China added 26 gigawatts of coal power into its grid. 26 gigawatts. And they're by all means not alone. Europe has been adding, Japan. Let's not even talk about the United States. I mean, I don't know what to think. I mean, you take it, but it just seems depressing right now.
No, I mean, depressing certainly is one of the most useful words in relation to climate situation. I think the power of having had this conversation in the G20 was, I think, partly supposed to be that the G20 is also a body that includes, obviously, powers from both Global South and the Global North, including South Africa, you know, the only African member. So in theory, that would have been, you know, a more egalitarian or slightly more egalitarian kind of forum to have this discussion rather than, say, the G7. But I think what it also showed is that the kind of economics of being a global South country, particularly one that is heavily dependent on exporting hydrocarbons, and the way that the complicated relationship between global North countries and global South countries and the geopolitics around all of that is now a part and parcel of the climate discussion, you know, and like, so there's no kind of getting around it. Like, these kind of breakdowns of trust between the different groups, and also these very real kind of economic dependency on continuing to sell hydrocarbons is also fundamental to an economy like South Africa's. So, you know, how to actually move those realities and how kind of hard they are to move, particularly as we're also seeing increasingly disrupted weather, there's a rock and a hard place kind of problem there. You know, I think that is kind of where we're stuck at the moment.
Well, we wanted to get a perspective on this because it's an issue that we've been wondering about. Again, you're going to hear slightly different takes on this from Cobus and myself, but we wanted to get kind of the big picture of the diplomatic architecture that's supposed to handle these discussions. And so we reached out to the folks at E3G, who's an independent climate change think tank with offices in the US, Europe, and Asia, and they follow these issues very closely. They came out with a statement after the G20 meeting in Chennai that was very, very critical. So we thought this would be the best place for us to start. And we're so grateful that two of their great analysts are joining us today to share some of their insights on it. Byford Tsang is a senior policy advisor in E3G's London office. He leads their work on EU-China climate diplomacy. Byford, thank you so much for taking the time to join us.
Thanks for having me.
And we're also joined by Madhura Joshi, who is a senior associate at E3G based in Mumbai, and she works on India's energy transition initiatives. Madhura, wonderful for you to be with us as well. Very good afternoon.
A very good afternoon, Eric. Thank you so much for having me.
Madhura, let's start with you. Because the meeting was in Chennai, you follow the issues in India very closely and what's been going on with the G20 process. You commented afterwards and you expressed your disappointment in the failure of the G20 to reach some kind of consensus. Why can't the G20 actually come to some kind of consensus again on a very milquetoast, bland ambition like tripling renewable by 2030? That doesn't seem like you're asking a lot. It's not a binding treaty of any kind. What's the problem here that we're missing?
Thanks, Eric. So I'd sort of caveat this by saying that we know that G20 negotiations over the last 2 years have been mired in geopolitical tensions. But maybe let's take a step back and just look at slightly a bigger picture. I'm an eternal optimist. And when you look at the bigger picture, you sort of see that conversations that are now taking place in the G20 and even on other climate forums would have seemed unimaginable. There is now focused attention on coal phase down. There is increasing discussion and countries backing fossil fuel phase out on doubling energy efficiency. All of these would have seemed very difficult to have in climate negotiations, even sort of a couple of years back. In the G20, I think it's also important to look at the discussions that took place in the energy ministerial. So a lot of the energy transition sort of fight happened in the energy ministerial. And of course, environment and climate ministerial also had elements of energy included in this. If you look at some of the sort of key sticking areas, I would highlight this in a few different ways. Yes, there was an ask on tripling global renewable capacity to reach 11,000 gigawatts by 2030. This in itself, I think this ask that happened in itself is remarkable. And while the language did not make it into the outcomes document and was more reflected in the chair summary, what it did help in showing is the extent of number of countries that also supported this ask. It is not an easy task. And yes, you're right that most of the language in G20 has been voluntary. But what I find a little encouraging is the question is not about debating if, but it's about debating how and when this will be achieved. So even leaders are being cautious about the commitments that they're making to ensure that this is something that they can look at achieving. Now, the reason for not supporting renewables or tripling renewables ask or will sort of take time to unpack a little bit. It ranges from the issue question on finance. It also sort of is about, are we looking at renewables, what type of renewables, how fast this can grow, and the kind of sort of support and knowledge networks that can be created to sort of meet these targets. And at least the G20 negotiations have shown very strongly the countries that are in support and provides us time between now and COP28 to try and also address the concerns and for countries to increase diplomatic outreach with the quote-unquote blockers of this to try and resolve and come to a point which will take the conversation forward. I also think that the G20 energy ministerial this time did have some good positives in it, which was around the language on doubling energy efficiency, the rate of energy efficiency improvements between now and 2030, the strong focus on distributed renewable energy and the need for clean energy to be a large part of energy transitions. So encouraging that these topics are being seriously considered and discussed, but definitely I do see that the politics of sort of climate diplomacy are not keeping pace with the realities of climate change. And we hope that in the sort of run up to COP28 and the various sort of platforms that are there, as well as going ahead beyond COP28, that leaders show strong, decisive sort of commitments to act on climate change.
Byford, as Eric mentioned, in the aftermath of the failed G20 commitment to triple renewables, China was accused of having blocked it and then said that's a mischaracterization, but none of the comments from the spokespeople that I've read actually clarified what the situation is, like why there's a misunderstanding from their perspective. So I was wondering kind of what were some of the dynamics that were happening behind the scenes?
Sure. So it's not surprising because we have seen that China has taken a very hard stance on energy, also in last year's G20, when it opposed to some of the more progressive text on describing a global climate target that sticks the world to a 1.5 degree trajectory and also on the language on coal. I mean, China is doing this again this year. And in terms of the kind of dynamics that's happening behind this, China always prefer to announce any big kind of lofty policy targets on its own accord. If we look at one of the biggest climate policy targets China has put out in the past 3 years, the net zero target by 2060, it has announced that at the UN General Assembly, a speech by President Xi. And we saw that China's target to phase out coal finance internationally is also announced by Mr. Xi himself at the UN General Assembly a year later. So China likes to do these things on its own accord instead of announcing these big, the tripling renewable energy target is a big target. So, instead of announcing these targets together with other countries. So I think that's kind of the first dynamics. And the second one is, I think, going back to domestic energy politics, as Eric has mentioned in the beginning, in terms of China's renew coal build-out, we have seen actually the numbers have now increased. It's not 20 gigawatts, it's 50 gigawatts in the first 6 months. In the first 6 months. And just to put that in perspective, the entire existing coal fleet of power plant in Indonesia in South Africa is around 44 gigawatts, and China alone has approved 50 gigawatts of new coal-fired power plants in the first 6 months of this year. It's not what they have not been built, but they have been approved. They're in the pipeline. So there's a chance that they're going to be built. But going back to why they're building all of this, it's because of the heightened sense of energy security in China domestic policies. And that has been a policy priority for Beijing energy planners since, I would say, 2021, because there was a huge power blackout in the autumn of 2021 due to a number of reasons. A part of that is weather related. Part of that is energy planning policies, which led to a shortage of coal. But then since then, energy security is clear priority. We have seen speeches and policy documents talking about the absolute need to secure energy supply for the people. And when politicians talk about that, what they would like to say is that our energy policy will have to be aligned with China's resource endowment, being what they would say, rich in coal, short in gas, lacking in oil. So China imports over 70% of its oil, 40% of its gas, but in terms of coal, 90% of coal is produced domestically. So when China talks about energy security, coal is always the fallback option. And that is the narrative that is dominating the energy discussion in China for the past couple of years. So as much as we see China is now the leader in solar panels and EVs, electric vehicles, this coal energy security focused discussion is still dominating the energy politics in China, and hence the position that China is going to take domestically, but also internationally.
And just a little bit of background on China's energy mix. So Byford was talking about coal versus imported oil. A lot of that imported oil is used to power factories and business, whereas the coal powers a lot of the residential needs around the country. And hydroelectric also is very important. And one of the reasons that there's been an increase in coal usage is because of the temperatures. Even this year, but 2021, 2022, there was some real demand on the Chinese national grid because the water levels in many of the rivers that power the hydroelectric dams, particularly in the southwest of the country, around Sichuan, you know, in the far west, were running very low. This year alone, in the second quarter, the load on Beijing's power grid was up about 30%. There were also record highs in both Guangxi and Hainan provinces as well. Temperatures all summer in many parts of China have been north of 35 degrees, which is almost 100 degrees Fahrenheit. And that too has put demand on the system. Overall, the Chinese national grid is up about 5%. So it's done very well this year. But to Byford's point, in part because they've been boosting coal production to make sure that any offset from the hydroelectric is mitigated. So that's part of it. But Byford, just very quickly before we go on, and we don't want to spend the whole time on China, I do have one kind of philosophical question, that China is continually bashing the United States for behaving unilaterally and not going through the multilateral system. China loves to celebrate the UN and multilateralism. But based on what you're saying here, is that when it comes to multilateralism on issues of climate, they prefer a more unilateral approach. And so it's hard to reconcile the Chinese approach here, because on the one hand, they say, we hate the way the US does it, but it seems in many respects that they're behaving as unilaterally as, say, the US does in other issues. So it does seem to be a little bit of an inconsistency in how they approach these climate issues when it comes to multilateralism.
Right. So, and I think important point to point out is also what kind of multilateralism, because here we're talking about the G20, which is made up of a group of developed countries, including the US, and developing countries. And when I say China would like to do things on its own accord, I don't necessarily mean that it wants to do things unilaterally. Because if we look at the major policy announcement on climate by China in the past couple of years, it's made in the UN. So it's also a multilateral platform. But by doing that at the UN, China is seen as kind of providing or contributing to the United Nations on its climate policies. And it's also very important to point out that China would like to engage on the climate issue within the UN climate process, which is called the United Nations Frameworks on Climate Change, because within that framework, there is some principles regarding common but differentiated responsibility, meaning that developed countries, rich countries like the US, which has historically been pumping up most of the carbon emissions in the atmosphere, should be responsible more in reducing emissions, but also providing enough finance to support developing countries to reduce emissions. So within that UN framework, this principle, in a way, kind of shield China and other developing countries, sometimes rightly so, in doing more on climate. So that's, I think, why China likes to engage in some multilateral processes more so than the others, especially the ones where US has a say in that.
Madhura, we now see, I think, one of the emerging kind of effects, and I feel it very much in South Africa, where I live, is that countries like South Africa, countries like Indonesia, for example, global South countries that are very hydrocarbon dependent on their economies, are emerging as significant complicators of these discussions. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that broader dynamic, and what is some of the thinking, for example, in a country like India, about this double challenge of rerouting the economy in a way to run in a less polluting way, but then also the opportunity to kind of leapfrog into massive amounts of clean energy that could potentially transform the economy. So how is that thinking kind of happening in places like India, for example, and broader?
Thanks so much, Cobus. So I think, as you mentioned, there is definitely increasing recognition that investment in clean energy is useful, and the co-benefits, rather, not just from a climate sense, but the co-benefits of clean energy outweigh sort of the benefits, perhaps to some extent, of fossil economy. But there are tensions that exist in terms of the political economy and also capacities, financial and technical access when it comes to energy transition. In the context of India, I think when you look at just the clean energy space, the goals, targets, and policies that the government has put in place for renewables are fairly ambitious. India is looking at 450 gigawatts of renewables by 2030, 500 gigawatts of non-fossil capacity. They also have domestic policies which are looking at increasing the share of renewables in electricity generation to over 40% by 2030, and looking at mandates on necessary RE generation targets for even thermal power plants that exist. At the same time, there is contradiction, I think, that sort of stems to some extent from technical conservatism, where coal is still seen as needed for the electricity future of the country. The tension on whether coal is the route to energy security, the past sort of narrative around this, or whether RE is the route to energy security is still live. And I think the challenge also arises from the fact that power demand, to some extent fueled by climate change as well, when you look at sort of the extent of heating requirement or cooling requirement that's increasing on an annual basis, makes it difficult to sort of predict how much the power demand will likely grow. So there is some technical conservatism that is there within the countries as well on continuing the dependence on fossil fuels, as well as strong political economy interests of entrenched fossil fuel companies and the sector itself. Having said that, I think when we look at the domestic policies and targets that exist within the countries versus what their stance could be at global politics, there's definitely some difference in this. As you mentioned, in the case of South Africa, if I'm not wrong, the domestic NDC commitments are looking at least a 5 to 9% increase in the current RE goals, and are likely to be, I think, 1.5 times more than what is the existing 2030 target. So domestically, they are looking at a more sort of ambitious future for renewable energy. But that sort of domestic politics do not always translate into international commitment, because I think the question around availability of finance and availability of technology become front and central in international politics. And also there is also this whole sort of sentiment on which country is acting faster, rather, and commitments will come forth only if you see stronger progress happening from the more developed countries.
So, Madhura, I want to follow up on that, and I understand where your optimism is coming from in terms of the fact that conversations are happening, and that is important, but you know, to use a baseball metaphor, which I think will land flat with this crowd, we're in the seventh inning now. I mean, this game is full underway, and I don't know if we have the time left to be talking and to be celebrating just the fact that people are getting together and having conversations that should have been happening 15 years ago. But let's put that aside. There's more things that I don't understand. Just as I brought to Byford my confusion, I'm going to bring some things I don't understand to you. Why would Russia and Saudi Arabia ever agree to these types of things when their entire economies are based on the exportation of fossil fuels? The United States, by the way, is the largest fossil fuel producer in the world. Why would they agree to anything? And by the way, any hope that any binding treaty and commitment will get through the United States House of Representatives or the Senate is never going to happen in the contemporary politics of the United States. So that's just fantasy, okay? So that being said, if China is making decisions, as Byford laid out, on very domestic considerations, 80% of the energy that your country uses is either biomass, coal, or oil. And then you look at where Cobus is in South Africa, 200,000 people are tied to the coal industry. The African National Congress, which is already on its back foot because of the Eskom fiasco and the fact that it can't deliver energy to its people, is not going to start implementing policies that are going to be laying off 200,000 coal miners. So the politics and the economics in each of these countries in many ways make it prohibitive to actually implement the kind of change that I think you and your colleagues at E3G are advocating for. So do we have the time left before the world just heats up and messes us up to implement the changes that are needed? Because I don't see it happening, and I'm just struggling to understand where the optimism comes from on that front.
You're very right that the window of opportunity for us to act and act fast on climate change is definitely reducing, and we do need to see a step change and increase of commitments and implementation on the ground from countries. But the optimism comes from the fact that if you look at the numbers on the ground, there is a movement of change that's taking place. Not fast enough, but definitely faster than what it has been in the last sort of decade and a half or even more. So to give you an example, yes, coal has been sort of, or is rather, a mainstay for India. But if you look at the fall in sort of the pre-construction pipeline in coal in India, it's been massive. And we know for a fact that any new coal project that is announced at the moment is unlikely, rather, to come online in the next sort of decade. And a lot of times these announcements are stemming from a reactionary measure to energy power crisis of sorts, where this is seen to be, you know, doing something. But annually, the installations of clean energy are far outpacing any installations on coal. And when we talk about transitions also, it is important to sort of put it in a temporal context. When we say that phasing down coal, it doesn't mean that all coal power plants and mines will shut down tomorrow. It's about strongly showing what the direction of travel is and then taking the time between now and 10 years, 15 years from now to ensure that there is a planned and phased transition that happens that can account for the workers and the communities that are dependent on these economies, as well as the regional sort of governments that sort of look at fossil sectors for their source of income, or at least part of their source of income. So the idea is not to, and I think we sort of need to focus on the temporal aspects of transitions as well, where a commitment right now does not mean that 200,000 people lose their jobs immediately tomorrow. It basically means that the investments will flow then into sectors that can provide energy to sort of secure supply of energy to the large population, meet developmental needs, as well as provide social plans and packages for communities and alternate investment strategies for regions so that they are best equipped to deal with the changes that are coming forth. And the fact of the matter also is, why would these economies look at agreeing to this? I think the conversation, whether or not it's accepted in international fora, but all countries have now accepted that climate change is real and it is definitely happening. So whether now or in the future.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. The Republican Party of the United States does not accept that. And I know this might seem, you know, a little bit weird, but nothing gets passed if the Republican Party of the United States doesn't accept it. So yes, the White House does, But if the Republican Party, as part of their platform, doesn't believe this, and we may have a Republican president again next year, this doesn't happen. And if the United States doesn't sign on, as we saw in the Paris Accords, it doesn't work. I mean, I didn't mean to interrupt you, Madhura, sorry, but it just, not every country is on board with this.
You're right. I completely left out the climate deniers, the large group of climate deniers in the Republican Party that exists. But essentially, if I was to maybe not look at the Republican Party for the sake of this point over here, at least in the oil and gas companies, yes, they're looking at benefiting from this rush till the very possible last minute. But at the country level, I do think that there is a recognition, at least at the domestic level, to see whether these policies can, what are the sort of transition pathways needed. You've had UAE that is sort of committed to no new coal and looking at reducing its oil and gas consumption. It may not happen at the pace that we would like it to, but there is hopefully a recognition that a steeper transition much later down the years will be harsher for the economies than a more gradual and planned transition. And that's what the hope is with all the climate conversations.
Yeah, maybe I can come in on this. I think, well, in terms of maybe I can take the Republican Party point into this conversation. I mean, despite that there is a major political party in the US that might, you know, take the next presidency, denying climate change is an actual scientific issue. I would say that the fact that whether that's G20 or the COP climate negotiation, like a group of major countries in the world getting together, agreeing on something, sending some political signals, even they might well be empty rhetoric, could actually have real world consequences. So since the Paris Agreement, we have now seen that over 70 countries have set net zero emissions target covering 76% of global emissions. And obviously we can say that's all empty rhetoric, but what it does in the real world is that it sends signal not only to policymakers or the citizen, but also very importantly to investors that a lot of governments in the world will be phasing down emissions and hence fossil fuel technology in the next 50 to 60 years. Which means that investors would then take that signal and say, oh yeah, we need to go the other way. We need to, you know, pull out investment from fossil fuel and increase our investment in renewable. And we are seeing that. I mean, since the Paris Agreement, we now see that what the investor calls Paris alignment is standard practice in corporate sustainability policies, in sustainable investment policies. And since, you know, the talk about coal phasing out have started in the Glasgow Climate Accord 2 years ago, we have seen that a lot of institutional investors are now getting rid of coal utilities in their investment portfolio because inclusion would mean that they might miss out on more lucrative investment opportunities. So the point I'm trying to make is, yes, there might well be Republican Party or the next president of the US denying climate change as a real issue, but the world has moved on. There are people, investors, and civil society and citizens in the world that will be taking action and that would lead to change in the world. Bit by bit, as Madhura would say, but I think it's why I'm still optimistic about this issue.
I'd also like to come in over here on a couple of different points, just to sort of substantiate what Byford was saying as well. If you look at coal as well, since the Paris Agreement, the global pre-construction pipeline for coal has collapsed by 72%. Now, there are just a few handful of countries that still have coal in their pipeline. The G7 sort of commitment on ending finance for coal and fossil fuels has also had impact in terms of how much money is going into or whether there is finance available for new coal projects. So I think there is some progress. And even under the Republican president before Biden, under Trump, we saw that the US subnationals had stepped up significantly their climate action. And yes, the US had pulled out from the Paris Agreement, which was a major blow. But at least domestically, there was still work taking place at the state level, and perhaps even more so than before, to counter the sort of global position that the president had taken. So some sort of levers of optimism also, because like I'd said earlier, from a clean energy transition perspective, it makes competitive and economic sense. And for those that are not investing in it are going to lose out in the long term.
Byford, I wonder if we could talk a little bit about the financing options involved here. So we recently featured writing by Firdaus Kayadi, a climate expert in Indonesia, who was critiquing the Just Energy Transition Partnership that Indonesia struck with the G7. And, you know, kind of saying that increasingly civil society in Indonesia is starting to characterize this as a kind of a debt bomb. And to a certain extent, they're kind of, you know, turning the language of debt trap diplomacy that has been used against Chinese infrastructure in the global south a lot by Western leaders against the West. So in the case of South Africa, for example, their Just Energy Transition Partnership, the grant component of that financing package is only 4% of grants. The rest will be in different forms of loans. I think 62% in concessional lending and then the rest in commercial lending. So, you know, how worried are you that these countries will be able to absorb this debt? And is there some kind of way around the financing where it isn't just like, oh, let's hook a huge cash truck up to the bank account of BlackRock? You know, like, is there a way around this where the logic just doesn't kind of feature immediately circle back into, oh, Western public, you know, kind of investors need to profit?
Yeah, so I think, yeah, the concerns that you have just laid out around the Just Energy Transition Partnerships is well-founded in terms of the mix of finances and the debt implications that it would pose to the developing countries. And if we look at the kind of Belt and Road initiatives and the financing model and the type of finances going into these countries, it paints a very similar picture. We recently have done some analysis on China climate finance. So looking at all the investment through the Belt and Road initiatives by the major policy banks in China in the past decade on the things that they've invested in on that is climate related. So that ranges from renewable technologies to flood defenses to water supply projects to risk disaster management programs. So if we take into account all of that, China is actually investing in quite a bit on some of these programs, and that adds up to over $1.3 billion per year. But the point I'm trying to make here is if you look at the mix of finances, it's very similar to what you've just laid out in the Just Energy Transition Program. Not a lot is in loans, but a lot of that is in grants. So I think there's an issue there. And in terms of how we can be able to fix that, there are some new ideas that are coming up in terms of how we actually mobilize existing finances and mobilize existing financial institutions, and namely the multilateral development banks. So that's the likes of the World Bank and the IMF. And a way to do that is to think about how we kind of optimize their balance sheet in terms of changing some of the rules around that so that they will be able to increase their lending with the existing finances that they have. And these are some of the issues that is already being explored in the World Bank discussion, but also in a summit that is co-hosted by President Macron of France and Prime Minister Mia Motley of Barbados. Back in June, there was a summit on the financial pact in Paris that talks about how we can actually use different financing sources, including the MDB, and also new sources of finance, including tax from the aviation industry on their emissions, to think about how we can create new ways to put in finance for renewables and mitigation and adaptation projects.
Madhura, I'm going to give you the last word. We've covered a lot of ground here. You and Byford are both optimistic, which again, it is a nice kind of contrast to my cynicism and skepticism. So I do appreciate it. And I don't mean that in any condescending way. I really do. It's helping me kind of round out my point of view. That being said, there is good reason for developing countries to be very concerned about the direction that things are going. Just as we've seen in debt issues and in other issues that disproportionately impact the global south, they tend not to benefit the most. And the decisions are made in the global north and oftentimes in the interests of the global north. When you have a chance to speak with policymakers, stakeholders, and others in developing countries, Asia, elsewhere, and they ask you and they say, Madhura, what's going on? How do we position our countries to accept the realities as they are, not what we want them to be? What do you tell them?
That's a really interesting question, Eric. I'd sort of approach this in a few different ways. The first is there's definitely a need to continuously call out the sort of hypocrisy almost that is there in a lot of the statements or the policies and actions of the global north. This entire approach on do as we say and not as we do towards developing and emerging economies is definitely now coming to a point where there is increasing mistrust that sort of permeated across different platforms. But I think more countries calling out and consistently calling out these discords have also yielded to some minor, at least, policy action from countries where there is a need to reconcile what their politics and what their commitments also look like from a global north perspective. The second I would sort of say is sometimes there's also a need a little bit to distill the hype from the reality on the ground. What I mean by this is there's been extensive coverage for right reason about the EU or Germany looking at restarting coal power plants to meet sort of their energy security or energy crisis challenges over the last couple of years. But the numbers on the ground paint a different picture, where you still have in Germany, for instance, renewables as a central part of the response to energy crisis. They've in fact increased their RE targets from 65% to 80% by 2030. And the government remains very strongly committed to coal phase out by 2030. Even in the case of EU, RE remains central to actually their energy security concerns. They've increased their RE target to 42.5%. They have a gas demand reduction target as well, I think to 50% by 2030. So there are these developments that are taking place. So short-term measures should definitely be monitored to ensure that these remain short-term, but it's also important to see whether the long-term or even the medium-term direction of travel remains consistent or in fact enhanced, and reflect that in emerging and developing economy narratives as well, that there is still a huge movement taking place towards clean energy. The second is, I think, from an emerging and developing economy perspective as well, I think is makes economic sense, as I mentioned earlier, to continue investing in clean energy where they have the fiscal space to do this. It's important that the public money is used in options that will increase their competitiveness and benefit them in the long run, or they risk, there is a real risk of being disadvantaged and playing catch up again, because a lot of countries will not have the kind of fiscal space to announce billions of dollars in subsidies to fast track energy transitions like we've seen with the IRA in the US or the clean economy package in the EU. So that kind of fiscal space is not going to be available for countries that are slower to transition. The fourth point I would make is that there are also, I think, differences that we need to highlight when we talk about emerging and developing economies. It's not a homogeneous block. Some are far ahead in the development sort of curve, have stronger ability than others. And I think there are at times tendency to hide behind the poor when it comes to positions on energy and climate, even within the bloc. For instance, does it make sense to build new coal power plants today? Economic sense, it doesn't. But we would still have arguments that are being used on energy security and on common but differentiated responsibilities to continue reliance on something else that we know is now a sunset industry. So I think that also is something that we need to be mindful of. There will be increased support definitely required for developing countries that don't have the access to capacities and to affordable finance. But there are several within this EMDE block, emerging and developing economy block, that have the capacity to at least undertake a large part of the transition on their own. And the last one I would say is that there is an important need to build capacities and capabilities and sort of have access to knowledge networks. And what I mean by capacities is local capacities, administrative capacities, capacities to understand the changing nature of the energy systems itself, because that is definitely changing, access to technologies and affordable finance, and what are the sort of solutions that can help in doing this, and knowledge networks, which is really important because there is multiple experiences on various issues from just transitions to decarbonizing the electricity grid to integrating renewables and storage that are taking place in different parts of the world. And sort of tapping into these knowledge networks can help in developing different pathways that are more climate resilient and can help in accelerating energy transitions for developing economies. So I think addressing these information and access asymmetries would be also important. So these would be the five things that I would tell sort of policymakers that yes, there is hypocrisy, there is a need to call that out, but also from a domestic self-interest perspective, it makes economic sense to accelerate transitions.
Well, that's a great note for us to end on. Madhura Joshi is a senior associate at the climate policy think tank E3G based in Mumbai, and her colleague Byford Tsang, who is a senior policy advisor also at E3G in their London office, who works on EU-China climate diplomacy. Byford, Madhura, thank you both for taking the time to join us and to really help us have a much broader understanding of this critically important topic. We really appreciate your time today.
Thank you so much, Eric and Cobus. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Yeah, thank you both.
Cobus, I'm so glad that Madhura, at the end of our discussion, brought up this question of the hypocrisy, because that, I think, needs to be called out more. That the politics of energy are local and short-term and oftentimes in the immediate. So you saw in Europe, after the gas from Russia was cut off, they switched to other gas suppliers and coal. Japan was the same way when they shut down their nuclear industry. And in South Africa, your politics are oftentimes driven by the moment. And so one of the contradictions in climate policy that it is hard to reconcile for people like Byford and Madhura who are in it is this contradiction of, yes, the major impact is still long-term, but the immediate political impact is short-term. So can you imagine if the ANC signs on to a lot of these ambitious goals to triple renewable, and those are things that it's going to do in 6-7 years, long after this current election is going to be over, when Ramaphosa is up for re-election. He would be getting hit by opposition saying, you're sacrificing the coal industry, right? I mean, that's certainly what happens in the United States, and that's certainly what happens in a lot of countries, given the fact that these lobbies are very powerful.
I think in the case of South Africa, I think that call would be coming from inside the party. I think, you know, so it would be a faction within the party, yes.
It would be from a rival of some kind, sure. But that's because in many cases, you don't have a real peer domestic competitor to the ANC that can really have the leverage to pound them. So it would come from factions within the ANC, but it would make the job of implementing that policy extraordinarily difficult. And I guess this is where I come down on the cynical side of the debate, that I personally don't think that we're going to reach a meaningful consensus on this. And I think that we're going to descend into a form of climate anarchy. That's my personal take, that the world is going to burn up in many parts. Some are going to suffer vastly more than others. And we as human beings are very, very comfortable in letting other people die while we enjoy our martini on a nice warm afternoon in southern Sweden.
I think you make a lot of good points. In the case of South Africa, and I would hazard to guess also in many other developing economies, there is the additional issue of the massive gap simply in service delivery, and particularly kind of a massive gap in electricity access in these societies. So it's a bit different from the US, for example, like where there is a very well-developed grid and then very vested interests kind of like, you know, within there. In the case of South Africa, the conversation is mixed up by the fact that there's a lot of people who just simply don't have electricity at all, you know, kind of where like old school kind of conventional electricity never reached them. So there is a lot of kind of developmental gap that needs to be made up by simply increasing electricity provision as a whole. And in there, particularly in rural areas, then, you know, frequently now, you know, kind of as prices are shifting in the world, doing that via solar or doing it via kind of microgrids that don't need to be connected to urban grids far away, you know, does change that conversation a little bit. It's a bit of a different mix, you know, of issues, I think, in the global south than it is in the global north. But I think you make a really important point. This kind of short-termism and kind of like small meanness, you know, kind of that we see in climate decision-making in rich countries is really very much a problem and very much a factor. But of course, rich countries are burning. You know, I mean, like, you know, Maui has burnt. You know, Canada is burning all the time. Roads went up in flames in Greece. So every year, there's more and more of these kind of disasters within the global north. You know, to the extent where insurance companies are starting to make certain regions uninsurable, and etc. The crisis is gaining traction in the global north too. You know, and that then also, I think, moves the political needle a little bit, I think, in the global north. The massive amounts of smog that hit New York earlier this year because of the fires in Canada.
But what evidence do you have to support that? Yeah, you're putting all these dots on the chart. Yes, all of that happened, But what evidence do you have to suggest that the needle has been moved?
Well, I'm mostly just looking at how much the discussion is showing up in the media. That's all. Because before there was a crisis, but there was no discussion. Right?
That's different than politics and then different than policy.
Yeah, but media discussion does inform politics in the US particularly, right? Kind of like when the Washington Post and the New York Times write about things, then that becomes real.
It doesn't, though. But this is the problem. Half the country doesn't read the New York Times and the Washington Post. You know, Joe Manchin's in West Virginia, his constituents don't give a crap about the Washington Post and the New York Times. And so he votes for his constituents who are watching Newsmax and Fox News in their own information bubble, which says there is no climate change. This is a liberal conspiracy. That's what they hear. And that's what they're responding to. I think the framing that you've put forward is 15, 20 years out of date when the Washington Post did that and people had that kind of influence. But they don't today. And the narratives today are so polarized. And this is not just in the United States. This is in other countries, too. So I'm just not convinced that there's any needle being moved. Here's what I'm going to be interested, Cobus. You are going up to Berlin now for the next 3 months to do a fellowship on climate issues. And it's going to be very interesting to get your perspective when you are up in Germany. Because when you're in a place like Germany, just as I was just in California. In fact, I was just in Berkeley, California a few weeks ago. And in the middle of the summer, it was chilly. You heard about the U.S. burning up in terms of temperatures and people, you know, getting third degree burns from falling on the streets in Arizona. But in the Bay Area where I was, it was cold and we had sweatshirts on. And the point here is that you're going to be sitting in this comfortable northern climate where climate change is an academic issue. Just the same way that they're starving people in other parts of the world, we should help and be worried about them too, right? But that's far away. My life here, my day-to-day, going to work, picking up my kids, going to the supermarket, is not really impacted by climate change in a meaningful way. And that's the fundamental problem. There is still a massive disconnect. Yes, Maui's burning up. But for those people in California, Wyoming, Illinois, who cares? It's an academic issue. It's far away. And I think it'll be interesting to get your perspective now when you're on the other side and life is nice and comfortable.
Yeah, I mean, you know, obviously you're right. Like I imagine, you know, kind of like a lot of kind of disjunctures and cognitive dissonances, you know, will fly around. And I take your point. Like, I think, you know, the kind of overlap of temperate climate and richness, you know, kind of that happens to kind of to dominate the global north, you know, is obviously a really big factor. I think the issue is more these enclaves and little islands of wealth, they obviously will remain rich, you know, for a while at least. But at the same time, it's not like they're in outer space, right? Kind of like Europe particularly is so hepped up about African migration. And the migration implications of climate change is just off the charts, right? Kind of is beyond anything that Europe has ever faced. And it's probably coming in the next few years. So,
and by the way, not just Africa, but the Middle East as well. There was a new survey that came out, 40%. Of the youth in MENA want to move to a different country. And when they say they want to move to a different country, they don't mean they want to move south. They want to move north.
Yeah, you know, so that's the thing, right? Kind of it's like there's a limit to how long everyone can pretend there isn't a crisis, right? And certain people will definitely try and hold on as long as they can. But then what will then become also interesting is to see how that then shapes their relevance in the rest of the world. Some of the big issues around once carbon markets become more standard, once you know, as the EU is already moving towards like supply chain emission tracking, you know, for imports. As all of these kind of like measures start moving, the more then someone like Joe Manchin or the Republicans or so, like definitely, obviously, they're sitting on a big kind of domestic power base, of course, which will keep them going for a while. But, you know, no one goes forever, right? and so then definitely, like as the more unplugged these countries are from this kind of wider world reality, the less relevant they'll become, even though their own power means that, you know, will buy them a certain amount of influence for a while, obviously. But still, that influence can wane.
Yeah, and it can wane fast, too. This is a topic that, because of Cobus's upcoming fellowship in Germany, for the next 3 months, again, you're going to be joining us from Berlin, not from Johannesburg. We're going to be talking about quite a bit. Also, we have dedicated correspondents in Nairobi and in Jakarta who are focusing exclusively on the climate impact specifically related to Chinese engagement in those regions, but also more broadly. So if this is a topic that you're interested in, we've got a lot of great information. We'd love for you to join our growing community of readers around the world. You can subscribe to the China Global South Project and support the work that Cobus is doing and that the rest of the team in Asia, Africa, and the Middle East are doing just by going to chinaglobalsouth.com/subscribe. If you are a student or a teacher and you don't have a lot of money, which is a typical thing for students and teachers, we have a solution for you. 50% off discount for subscriptions, just $7 a month. Very, very cheap for students and teachers. So email me and I will send you a link. You can email me directly at Eric, E-R-I-C, at chinaglobalsouth.com. And I'll send you the links for the 50% off discounts to get a subscription. We want to thank everybody on our Patreon community and to our subscribers for helping to make the work that we do possible and the independent journalism that we do every single day about China's engagement in the Global South. And we're so proud of everything that the team has done and also very grateful to your support. So again, just a little thank you and a little gratitude at the end of our show today. Let's leave it there. Next week, Cobus will be joining us from Germany, no more from South Africa for a few months, and we're looking forward to that. Have a safe trip, Cobus, and we'll speak again next week from Germany and Vietnam. I'm Eric Olander for Cobus Van Staden. Thank you so much for listening.
The discussion continues online. Follow the China Global South Project on Twitter at ChinaGSProject and share your thoughts on today's show or head over to our website at chinaglobalsouth.com, where you can subscribe to receive full access to more than 5,000 articles and podcasts. Once again, that's chinaglobalsouth.com.